The Metroid series does many things well, but something that sets it apart is the way that it establishes a deep sense of immersion in each of its game's worlds. There's a palpable mysteriousness emblazoned in every detail of the graphics and the music, but much of the unknown is derived directly from the science-laden plots. Each game poses great scientific questions that regularly intertwine our heroine with the events of each fateful excursion. As the story goes, Metroid Fusion begins after an incident on the surface of SR388. Samus is commissioned to return there, this time to aid a research group tasked with observing the ecological hierarchy of the planet following the extinction of the Metroids. She becomes infected with a parasite simply named X and nearly dies as the organism takes over her neurological system and the biological components of her power suit. In a last-ditch effort to save her, a researcher injects what they've called a vaccine prepared from Metroid tissue cells. This cell culture has been harvested and maintained from the last known Metroid, and once in her body, its cells were able to destroy the X parasites and save Samus's life. It's all a riveting tale, and truth be told, there's some really good science here despite a few fundamental flaws in what's actually happening at the molecular level. I won't touch much on the ecological implications, because while it would be interesting to see how the X parasite rose to the top of that ecosystem after the loss of the Metroids as the apex predator, there's a lot to dive into on the level of the cell that I'd rather spend some time on instead. The first stumbling block is with how the game's backstory has defined a vaccine, but let's back up a bit. Our immune system is trained to protect us from things in the world around us, and to do that, it has the ability to distinguish between things that are considered to be self and non-self. Self is qualified as anything that's derived directly from us, like our own tissues and organs, for example. Anything that comes from outside of our own bodies is considered to be non-self. At the level of the cell, even minute variances in tissues from other members of the same species are too different from our own to be considered self. And this is why things like organ transplants or blood transfusions will fail if matches aren't carefully curated. With respect to human health, non-self entities can be disease-causing pathogens like bacteria, viruses, and parasites, or even non-living things like pollen grains, animal dander, or other allergens that can trigger an immune response. Getting back to vaccines now, their most basic purpose is to serve as a host's first exposure to a foreign entity to form what's called immune memory. Vaccines are made up of parts of disease-causing pathogens that don't actually hurt us, but they're similar enough to the real thing to let our immune system become familiar with their features. It's like seeing a picture of a wanted fugitive on the news before they come to your house disguised as a water heater repairman asking to come in. If you've seen what they look like, you can recognize the danger and know how to react appropriately. When a vaccine is injected into the human body, our immune system sees the features of the pathogen without the risks of the disease that the real deal would cause if we became infected, and it develops a response plan. Down the line in real life, if we ever do contract an infection with organisms that we're vaccinated against, our immune system remembers and will recognize the threat and how to deal with it quickly and efficiently. What was administered to Samus in Metroid Fusion's opening is not a vaccine in the traditional sense. It's more similar to something like an antibiotic, but different because we're employing a living organism to do the killing instead of a chemotherapeutic agent like a medication. Based on what we know of the immune response, those introduced Metroid cells are also non-self and under normal circumstances should be destroyed by her immune system. In the game's universe, though, the Metroid cells actually persist inside of her body, and Samus eventually integrates part of their DNA with her own. Since the X parasites are natural enemies of Metroids, and Samus possesses Metroid tissue and their genetic information after a time, the X parasites relentlessly attack her as they would any other Metroid. This is pretty far-fetched for real life, but there are some true bits of science that could be applied to human health. On the most basic level, the injected Metroids that live inside of Samus would be better described as a form of biological warfare rather than a vaccine. Anytime a living thing is introduced into a system to destroy another as a form of therapy, it's a targeted intervention that works just as well as any kind of medication that could kill pathogens directly. An example of this is bacteriophage therapy. Bacteriophages are a type of complex virus that don't have any negative side effects in human hosts on their own. They only infect bacteria, many of which are responsible for causing devastating illnesses in human populations. If human hosts are having a hard time fighting off some bacterial infections, bacteriophages can be introduced to target and destroy the bacteria that are causing the sickness. Like other viruses, they enter and take over their target cells, multiply to large numbers, and cause the cells to explode or lyse, effectively killing them. While the game's backstory doesn't detail how Metroids kill the X-parasites inside or outside of Samus' body, we can only imagine the intense battles that might take place in a similarly gruesome fashion. The texts also describe Samus' integration of Metroid DNA with her own, essentially implying that she becomes one with the species in a way. She's so much a Metroid in nature that she can even absorb X-parasites as she kills their hosts to replenish her own energy. The idea of permanently housing another organism's DNA to gain special powers is technically impossible in complex eukaryotic organisms that are larger than a single cell. Every one of the millions of cells that make up large beings have their own DNA copy that would have to be altered. This is the same reason why we can't induce gene therapies for individuals in late stages of development and beyond. But that said, this phenomenon is observed very often in the world of bacteria. These are free-living, single-celled organisms that are at the mercy of their surrounding environment. They're susceptible to changes in pH and temperature, as well as fluctuations in chemical levels, but they can very easily adapt by changing their genetic makeup. They do this in a couple of ways. The first is by engulfing DNA that they find lying around in a process called transformation. A bacterium may gain access to new DNA this way after a nearby bacterial friend has died and their DNA is released from their cell envelope. A second way this can happen is far more deliberate through a process called conjugation. This is a direct DNA exchange between two living bacteria where, in a way that will seem all too familiar, one bacterium will shoot its DNA into a friend via a tube-like structure called a pilus. This newly acquired DNA has the potential to contain information to grant new adaptive abilities. Some examples of this might be genes that code for antibiotic resistance, or maybe some proteins that could help a bacterium adapt to large changes in temperature that would normally kill them. In the case of Metroid Fusion, the DNA integration event gives Samus a survival advantage, which is pivotal to help her in her fight against the X-parasites. There are two other features of the X-parasites that I wanted to spend some time on: how it specifically attacks the nervous system and how it takes control of its hosts. Many areas of the human body are regularly patrolled by our immune cells. They're looking for breaches of our body's main physical defenses, like the skin, for example. If you step on a nail and introduce foreign non-self entities into your system, your immune cells can reach that area via the bloodstream to fight off anything that could potentially harm you and begin the healing process. The nervous system is one of several areas inside the human body that are not regularly guarded by the immune system. Because of how precious the nervous system's function is, there are many other protections in place that negate the need for immune patrol. But some pathogens that enter the human body are sneaky and can take advantage of that absence. Infectious agents like those that cause chickenpox and shingles or the two herpes variants spend part of their infection cycles in our own nervous tissues to specifically avoid being detected by the immune system. Have you ever noticed that something like oral herpes comes and goes? One week you have a cold sore, the next you don't, and over time you'll see this consistent ebb and flow of that physical manifestation. During the time that oral herpes appears to retreat, it actually moves into the nerves that innervate the lips. Because nervous tissue isn't regularly patrolled by our immune system, the virus essentially hides there in an undetectable state that can't be purged from the body like other kinds of viral infections. The X-parasite seems to mimic this beautifully. The idea that the X-parasite can also take control of its host and assume its memories is also incredibly interesting. The closest comparator is a fungus from the genus Cordyceps. These organisms infect many different hosts and employ a form of mind control to spread their spores to new individuals and continue their life cycle. In many cases, infection with Cordyceps will cause members of large communities to act strangely as they're overcome by the infection. In the case of ants, for example, they'll crawl to a high place and cling to a branch as a fungal fruiting body bursts forth from their heads for a few weeks. After it develops, it releases spores from the tip to spread the infection to new individuals and perpetuate its own life cycle. The X-parasite's ability to completely overtake and dominate the minds and bodies of its hosts definitely has some disturbing parallels to the many, many variants of Cordyceps that exist and can affect a ton of different organisms. All said and done, I really love what the writers of Metroid Fusion were going for. The narrative they've weaved is compelling and dire, and they've sprinkled in just enough good scientific knowledge to concretely link it to our own world. It's those little connections that made Samus's plight feel tangible, like something that could happen to any one of us. With a few little tweaks in terminology to straighten out a couple of the details, it could have been a perfect parallel to our own living and breathing existence, constantly at the risk of the wondrous unknown.